Welcome back, guys. Today we're going to talk a little bit about BMS systems and how we can find faulty packs in our power wall. So let's take up the topics that we are going to discuss a little bit today. First of all, we are going to take a quick look at what is a BMS. What can you expect from a BMS and what are the functions? We are also going to take a look at why we want to use a BMS. And of course, the most common question currently is, why are some of them so expensive to comparing to others? What are the differences? And the last one is that some say you don't need a BMS. Is that really true? Can you handle and work with a battery bank without the BMS or not? Main topics to today is of course something totally different, and that's related to the Batrium system. First of all, the first question is, how can we find packs with a low capacity? Packs that are lower than the others, and how do we see that and how do we work with it? And how can we find packs that do have self-discharging cells? How is that visible in the Batrium system, and what makes the Batrium so much better than the Chinese BMS in that sense? So first talk about a little bit about the BMS itself. It generally stands for a battery management system, but it can also stand for a battery monitoring system. Today's topic is the management systems itself. This is fetched from the Wikipedia, and as you can see, it's an electronic system that manages a rechargeable battery cell or battery pack, such as protecting the battery from operation outside its safe operating area, monitoring its state, calculating secondary data, reporting that data, controlling its environment, authenticating and balancing it. So basically, the system is a battery management system. It makes sure that your battery bank stays as healthy as possible during the time that you don't need to do any work. We all know that battery systems that aren't protected and aren't managed properly will or can get issues in the long term. Note that the battery management systems as such is not a charger or a system that actually does that kind of things. The battery management systems is to actually protect the battery and the equipment itself. Let's take a look at some of the basic functionality that most BMS systems have. Even the cheaper ones from China do have most of this. First of all, it do protect for overcurrent and should be protecting for overvoltage and undervoltage. This is both the total voltage and individual cell voltages. It can also protect from over temperature and under temperature. Optimization is the next topic. It's generally referred to as balancing, and I'm not going to go deeply into the sections here. But we can say that we have two types of balancing in general, and that's passive and active. Active is when you transfer energy from one cell to another. Meanwhile, the passive one just wastes the energy to keep them in balance. You can also have top balancing or bottom balancing. Top balancing is when you keep all the cells at the same state of charge when they are fully charged or in the top state of the charge that you're using. Bottom is the other way around and kept in the bottom. What you choose to use is something that's up to you and depends on the scenario, and it's a totally different topic from today's video. Then we have monitoring part. Generally what we have talked to about so far is for the cheaper BMS systems. When we are stepping it up a little bit in the sense of money and the type of BMS that we're using, we get a lot more functionality. One of them are active monitoring. The system will be able to actually show you all the values and also send back the data that you need. There may be also be computation where it comes to actually calculating different stuff. For instance, the Batrium system that we are talking about today can do a lot of calculations and tell you a lot of information about the systems. So let's talk about why do we want a BMS. And this is something that depends on who you ask, but most people will likely say that you need or want a BMS to have the extra protection. First off is the what if. Lithium in all honor, batteries in all honor, we know what can happen to the batteries if something goes bad. And this is not about will it happen or can it happen or the batteries are safe or not. This is the what if. It can happen, it have happened. So the first thing that comes into mind when I'm talking about BMS system is the protection itself. I want to be sure that I have some system that can protect the batteries from the overvoltage, undervoltage, temperature, and whatnot. So that's my first thing. The second thing is, when you start to use secondhand cells, when you are scavenging from laptop packs or whatnot, may not be as safe as new cells. And that said, you do not know how they have been handled, and you do not know how old they are. New cells generally are tested and are at the same capacity, the same age, and will perform the same way. So when you're using secondhand cells, the likeliness of something that can happen is a little bit bigger, and even more important to use a protection system. So let's talk about the balancing function. If you have the cells equally balanced from the start, and the cells are the same type, the same age, the same, everything the same, they should potentially stay the same during their life cycle. And this is kind of true until you reach to an end, or to the fact that when they start to age unevenly, because not all cells are aging evenly. When you are doing that, the balancing comes in play. Also, some batteries, if we are not talking about normal standard lithium batteries, are not equally from even from the start, and they do shift the balancing a little bit. Balancing is rather simple, and it's not that you have to do a lot of balancing, but just keeping them a little bit more balanced will make them a little bit more even. Let's say you have one cell that is 10% off. That means in the end of the cell's capacity, you will have lost the 10%, because the other cells will have 10% left, and this poor bastard already are at the bottom. If you would have balanced that cell from the start, you would have been able to gain 10%. But once again, this depends on the cells that you are using. But with that said, in my experience with secondhand cells and even new cells, you need to balance some day or another. We also have the reporting back function. Reporting back, for me at least as a monitoring guy, is very important, because I want to know what's actually going on. We also have functionality to actually tell you the state of charge of the different packs, how they are performing. If you can do that, you can actually see what is going to happen in the future. You can see that one pack is falling behind more and more for each day, and you know that you need to swap that out soon. So that's also a key feature. So what about the China stuff versus the real stuff? Or in the real world, crap stuff versus the real stuff? First of all, the cheap BMSs are cheap of a reason. And I'm not talking about the sheep as in the animal, I'm talking about the sheep as in the price. I know that someone commented this last time. Nevertheless, the BMSs that you see from China for $5 or $10, they generally only have a very, very specific set of functionality, like overvoltage and undervoltage, and they are statically set. And the components may not be of the highest standard. So it's not a possibility to actually even compare that one to a real BMS. You have the cheap ones for a couple of dollars. They just do very, very spare functionality. And I consider those to be too small packs and e-bikes and stuff like that. We really don't care much about the battery pack. The next one is the managed BMS systems. I did a review of one earlier, and I have a video of that. That BMS costs around $50, and they are between $50 and $150. They are a better range of BMS systems. And they are still, as you can see, a little bit crappy in some terms. They do work generally, but do get the guarantee and protection that you actually want. The next range is the high-end range. They come from around $250 and up to $1,000 or even $1,500 or $2,000. They do so much more than just do the initial voltage protection. They do managing and everything else. So in the end, it's up to you to decide on what type of BMS or battery management systems that you are after. Are you only after the voltage protection or the managing functionality or a decent balancing function because you have secondhand cells that do fall out of line? Then you need to do the decision of how much are your batteries worth. If you have batteries for, let's say, $5,000, isn't a $200 BMS worth it then? Imagine the time you have spent on it. If you can extend that time a little bit, I would say it's worth it than going without no BMS. It is possible to go without the BMS or the cheap BMS. Just make sure that you cross-check your balancing and the voltages every now and then to make sure that they are aligned with one. So do we need a BMS? There are guys out there stating that you do not need a BMS. It depends on what you're going to do, if you ask me. It's the same as stating that you do not need cell level fuses. Yeah, of course you can go without them, but Tesla use them and some other cars don't. So what is that we need from the BMS itself? You need the protection. That's the important part. I would say that the balancing come in second hand, but first of all, we want to keep this safe. And to keep it safe, you need a protection, and the protection is the BMS. The balancing itself, yes, you can do without it, and many of us have done it, but suddenly you have a drop in voltages on one cell due to self-discharging cells, and this is very common on secondhand cells, and then the balancing is even more important to keep them track all the line. So, if you ask me, yes, you need a BMS. So let's talk a little bit about the main topic of today's video. How can we find packs with low capacity, and how can we find packs with self-discharging cells? So if you have followed me along all this time now, you know that to be able to do this easily, you need a system that do report back to you. You also need a system that do calculate or do some calculations, and in our term, that's the Batrium system that we are going to work with. One of the first things that many people come in mind is that you need to retest them to actually find the low capacity cells or low capacity packs. Yes, you can pull each pack out and retest them if you want, but there is an easier way if you're running the Batrium system. First of all, you make sure that you top them up so they are fully aligned, fully charged, and fully balanced. When you do that, you run them all the way down. Doing that, you will get a view like you can see in front of you here. I have 28 packs here, and you can clearly see that one of the packs falls behind a lot faster than all the other. And then I have two more that is significantly lower. So basically, this is how it works. So what or how do I know how much capacity are in them? If you take the right bar that you have in your Batrium software, you will have a couple of things, unless you change this, of course, like capacity empty. The capacity empty is how many amp hours you have left until the battery bank is empty. This, of course, demands that you have a shunt hooked up to the system. In my case here, you can see that my system states that there is 29 amp hours left in the battery bank until it's empty, but apparently it isn't. So when you see the cells drop off, you just note down this number and remove this number from the total capacity that you have filled in. Let's say I have 150 amp hours. Then I know that when the first cell starts to drop and it says 30 amp hours left, that pack only have 120 amp hours. That's a very, very simple thing to do, and you will easily find out what's going on without removing the packs. What's limiting you here now is that you can only do one pack at a time if you want accurate numbers. But with that said, generally we just do one pack at a time. We do the lowest one and then we keep going. So in my case, I should be doing the lowest here and then swap that one out or add a couple of cells and then do the next one. So let's take a look at how we can find packs with self-discharging cells. This is a little bit different, but still not that much off. So what you want to do is make sure that you want to cross-check how much the system is actually balancing the packs. Or you can balance the packs, shut off the balancing function, and let them sit fully charged. And the packs that goes down in voltage faster than everyone else most likely have some kind of self-discharger. first test that you can do, or the first visible sign of this, is when every time you are charging up your cells and you let them to top balance. In my case, I'm talking about a top balancing function because that's the most common one. But what if you all the time, on every charge, you have one cell falling behind? In the image here, you can see that I have one cell falling behind that doesn't have the red bar. And that means that every other cell is balancing except that one. If you can see one cell having this same scenario every damn day, that means you have an issue with that cell because that one is always falling behind. That's the first sign of a self-discharging cell. But what if you cannot sit around and wait and see and look at the dashboard for the Batrium software? What do you do then? There is another function for that. First of all, you go to the menu and you press telemetry. Then you press the cell info tab. When you have done that, you come into the telemetry tab for the cell information. In the cell information, you have a column for bypass milliamp hour. This is the column that you should be checking out. If you check this column out every other day in the evening after you have charged and topped the batteries off, you will get an indication of how the packs are doing. If you have one cell always falling behind, like in my image here, I have two cells with significantly lower milliamp hour, and that's because those two packs have not been balanced. Meanwhile, the other packs you see in this image have been balancing heck out of themselves to keep in line. So this is one way to also see it. Note that you cannot tell for sure until you actually have done an initial balance of the packs. So basically, guys, that's it. Wasn't it harder than that? No, it's not harder than that. That's how easy it is to actually find out if you have packs that are self-discharging or if you have packs with low capacity. With that said, you might be asking, but can't we have a better alternative to actually tell if packs are self-discharging? Do we really need to go in there every day and check it out? Because, I mean, I'm lazy. There is a way coming. I'm not sure if there's another way in Batrium software right now, but in my Grafana Raspberry Pi system, these numbers will be reported back in a soon future and will give you an indication of what's going on. But until then, I hope you enjoyed this video. I did not go too much into detail because I don't think that that's actually what you wanted today. I kept it rather simple and just got into some of the details that I think is important when it is to comparing the BMS systems. And I want to thank you for watching, and if you have any suggestions of what I could have missed or what you think is appropriate or needed in the next video about this topic, please let me know down in the comment and I will do everything to get them into a new video. And I will see you then. Bye.